Hey, everybody. You're listening to another edition of Ellsworth Adhesives Ask the Glue Doctor, the Internet's only expert podcast dedicated to talking about adhesive, sealant, coating, lubricant, dispensing, and curing applications. We're broadcasting from our state-of-the-art studios in Germantown, Wisconsin. And on behalf of everyone here at Ellsworth in Germantown and our offices around the world, I'd like to thank you for taking some time out of your day to download this podcast. I'm your host, Lance Brown. Today we're going to be talking about industrial lighting applications, and we'll be talking to Todd Klenk. Todd is a senior applications engineer in the in-place gasketing and sealing division at Dow Corning. Interesting topic this one, so let's get started. But before we do, Todd, I just want to thank you and all the folks at Dow Corning for helping to make today's podcast possible.
Thanks for having us.
All right, Todd, first question. Many lighting manufacturers make a wide range of housing or luminaire shapes and sizes, but they want a material that can effectively seal them all. What kind of material does Dow Corning have for this situation?
Lance, Dow Corning has several materials that can be used. Materials that can be robotically applied and used as a compression gasket, and materials that can be hand or robotically applied to be used as an adhesive. Let's first discuss the materials that we use as a compression gasket. We refer to them as cured-in-place gaskets, CIPG, and dispense foam gaskets, DFG. CIPG materials are a two-component liquid silicone rubber that are metered and mixed. Then they're dispensed by using a robot onto the part. Once dispensed, it's necessary to pass the part to an oven for full cure. And typically, this full cure is between like 100 to 150 C for 10 to 30 minutes. And that really kind of depends on the substrate and the exact temperature used in the oven. So this being said, you know, CIPG would not be the choice of a component that's made out of plastic, because some plastics can't withstand the higher temperatures, but others can. So we have to be careful on what we're selecting. These materials come in several durometers that range from 20 Shure A to 70 Shure A. Some are also formulated with an internal adhesion promoter that can eliminate the need for pre-applied primers or surface treatments for adhesion. Then we have the DFG products, dispense foam gaskets, that are also a two-component liquid silicone rubber material with a slightly different chemistry that allows the material to chemically generate small cells, creating a closed cell foam. We have materials to do this at room temperature and with low temp heat around 60 to 70 C. Some of the great things about the silicone foams are they have a very low water absorption rate, low compressive force, great low and high temperature performance, and they typically can replace many of the hand-applied adhesive-backed foam tapes or hand-placed preformed foam gaskets. Customers who wish to use an adhesive gasket can use our RTVs, our room temperature vulcanized, or silicone sealants. The gasketing type is called a formed-in-place gasketing, or FIPG. These materials are normally one part and will cure at room temperature over a period of time. They also typically require moisture from the air to cure, so the moisture level in the air will affect how fast the material will cure. The lower the moisture level, the slower it cures. So one-part RTV materials will cure in about 12 to 24 hours depending on the amount of RTV used, the joint design, the temperature, and of course, the amount of moisture in the air. Dow Corning also has two-component RTV adhesives that cure at a much faster rate. These are not fully dependent on the moisture of the air. So their cure rate is anywhere from 2 to 4 hours all the way down to 30 minutes depending on the material selected. Dow Corning also has the first silicone hot melt on the market, which is a FIPG material with strong adhesive properties when first applied. And a typical FIPG material, or formed-in-place gasket material, has very little strength until it has reached, let's say, over about 50% cure. Where the hot melt differs is right after application, when the material cools down to room temperature, it has very good tack strength, instant tack strength. Up to 18 PSI, as a matter of fact. It's still an RTV that requires moisture to fully cure, but once fully cured, it will not remelt when the heat is applied to it.
Why would someone choose a silicone seal over other materials?
Well, many organic materials don't have the weathering resistance, UV resistance, low to no fogging, which fogging is outgassing of the material and hazing of, let's say, a lens. high and low temperature performance, neutral cure for electrical and electronic compatibility that may be required for an outdoor and industrial light fixture. Another point is many builders use silicone as a material of choice when sealing anything outdoors due to its ability to perform for years and years without degradation.
All right. Well, is there a specific seal design that works better than others?
With a compression DFG or CAPG, there are a few variations of groove and gasket design that can be used depending on the part design. One of the important factors is the ability to control how much compression is put on the gasket, both minimum and maximum. Let me give you a few simple examples. A shallow groove with a limiter, where the groove is used to ensure that the gasket is in the correct location on the part. And it also provides a means to mechanically hold the gasket in place once it's assembled. This also requires some type of limiter, either by the fastener design or a feature design on the part to control the percent of the compression of the gasket. Another design is a void volume, where during assembly, the two components displace the gasket material in the groove. This design is used when trying to seal high pressure or aggressive fluids. The void area, the groove, is typically 10% larger than the worst-case condition. And what I mean by worst-case condition is, in other words, when the gasket is at its largest tolerance and the groove is at its smallest, we want to make sure that there's the 10% added void there available. Tongue and groove, this is another design similar to the void volume concept, except where the mating part has a protrusion that extends into the groove gasket area to compress the gasket in the groove. This is a common design and highly effective. The last type is a flat flange design, which is just a flat surface with no groove. The design will require the material to adhere to the surface for handling and also requires some type of compression limiter to ensure proper compression of the gasket. In designing an FIPG seal for non-serviceable parts, adhesion is one of the most important factors. Next would be the consideration of how much movement the joint may see from temperature fluctuations, shock, etc. For adhesion, the substrate plays an important role. Some plastics are extremely hard to adhere to and require added surface prep to obtain great adhesion. And, of course, that adds cost to the final part.
Todd, one of the things that we keep hearing again and again is that lighting customers are always under pressure to reduce labor costs and increase manufacturing throughput. How do these materials address this issue?
I'll cover a few of the possibilities to reduce per-part cost. The key to achieve this is through the use of an automated process. All three dispensing technologies can use this, the CIPG, FIPG, and DFG. And the direct result will be a reduction of manual labor, improved quality, waste reduction, reduced inventories, because instead of having 30 gaskets on hand, you'll have just one material that can do all 30 of those different gaskets, and increase throughput and more.
I think it's pretty common knowledge that ratings and approvals are very important in the lighting industry. Does Dow Corning have a material that can withstand an IP65 rating, or are they UL approved?
Yes, we have the materials that withstand the IP rating, IP65. IP stands for ingress protection. This IP rating is used to specify the strength of the enclosure that surrounds electronic equipment and is determined by a specific test. Each IP rating consists of using two separate measures. The first is protection against solids, and the second number is protection against liquids. So an IP rating of IP65 would be 6, totally protected against dust, and 5, which is protected against low-pressure jets of water from all different directions, with limited ingress permitted into the part. We do not carry the rating on a lot of our materials, but we'll pass the test as long as the part design is appropriate. So, yes, with the appropriate design and material, we have material that can pass both the IP65 and the IP67 rating. Additionally, we do have some products that are UL approved, but not all products. We currently have several products that we have tested internally and no pass the UL testing, but they don't have a UL approval. However, these materials are also being used in the lighting applications that do have UL approval. So, ultimately, the entire housing needs to comply with the rating, not just the ceiling material.
Todd, I understand that dispensing equipment is needed for some of these materials. Can you describe the process for selecting and implementing the equipment?
Typically, the FMPG can be done with a simple pail or drum pump and a material pressure regulator and a dispense valve. I prefer more control than that, as any material that is in excess is waste, and skimping also could cause high scrap rates or warranty issues. Like for the CIPG and DFG, it's necessary to have some type of servo-driven closed-loop metering system that will provide very constant flow of material along with a robot that can provide a very constant feed rate for the path that it's intended to dispense. Now, either rod or piston metering are preferred. Gear metering can be used, but only if we can determine the material does not have an abrasive filler. Gear meters tend to wear quickly with some of the fillers used in some of the products. You can also look at complete solutions provided by Ellsworth. They can supply product and equipment.
Todd, once again, I want to thank you for your time today.
Thank you.
And with that, good people, we wrap up another edition of Ask the Glue Doctor. And again, thanks for taking the time to download this podcast. If you have any questions about this podcast or Dow Corning products for your application, be sure to visit us at ellsworth.com. You can also reach us by calling 877-454-9224, or when you visit our website, click on the Ask the Glue Doctor banner on our homepage to chat directly with one of our Glue Doctor technical support specialists. Don't forget, Ellsworth Adhesives offers a wide selection of Dow Corning products on our website and through our global network of Ellsworth offices and engineered sales reps. Be sure to check out our other Ask the Glue Doctor podcasts on our Glue Doctor University page on our website, or subscribe to our podcast directly through iTunes. Just search Ask the Glue Doctor and hit subscribe. They're always free and you'll receive notifications when we add new podcasts. Before I sign off, I'd like to announce that we've just completed a new video so you can learn more about Ellsworth and our services. You can find the link on our homepage at ellsworth.com. So see you all soon. Take care.